Tunisia's president says he's dismissed Prime Minister Hichem Mechichi and suspended parliament in a move the head of parliament says is unconstitutional. It follows nationwide protests over the handling of the coronavirus pandemic and a struggling economy. Alexi O'Brien reports.
Celebrations on the streets of Tunisia's capital, Tunis, in the hours after the president dismissed the prime minister and suspended parliament for 30 days.
It's the first time in my life I've heard the head of a state make a right decision. We've taken our country back. This is the first time we're out on the streets to celebrate.
President Kais Saied's supporters made their way through the streets, welcoming news of political change. Earlier, thousands had protested in several cities about government failures and crippling coronavirus rates. Crowds shouted slogans against the ruling Ennahdha party and Prime Minister Hichem Mechichi, calling for the dissolution of parliament and chanting down with the regime.
We have come down today to resist this regime. They take our money and curse us. They have not done anything to the people always fighting. It is enough. How can 9 ministers rule an entire country? We have starved and the people are lost.
Police blocked all streets leading to the city's main thoroughfare, using tear gas to break up the crowds. It was a key site for the Tunisian revolution a decade ago that toppled longtime president Zine El Abidine Ben Ali and unleashed the Arab Spring uprisings. Soon after, the president called an emergency meeting, saying the measures were needed to save the country.
The first decision is to freeze all the powers of the parliament. The constitution does not allow the parliament to be dissolved, but it does not stand in the way of freezing all its work. The second decision is to lift the immunity of all members of parliament and for those of whom a case is related to. I will take care over the public prosecution.
But critics, including the Speaker of Parliament, have called the president's actions a coup.
These decisions have no basis in the Constitution nor in the law, and we are against them because, in short, it is a coup against the Constitution, a coup against the revolution, and a coup against public and private liberties in the country. The president made a misinterpretation that actually clashes with the reality.
Analysts suggest a rivalry between the president, prime minister and speaker has prevented action to tackle surging unemployment and crumbling state services. Tunisia's also been overwhelmed by the coronavirus, facing one of Africa's worst outbreaks. Hospitals are overcrowded and under-resourced. On Saturday, it reported a record 317 deaths from the virus. To many, the country's deepening economic and social problems have undermined support for democracy. Some critics say that very democracy is now in danger. Alexi O'Brien, Al Jazeera.
Meanwhile, there's been a standoff outside the Tunisian parliament. The gates are locked and Speaker Rachid Ghannouchi has been told he's not allowed in. Ghannouchi has said he still considers Tunisia's institutions to be standing and called on MPs to consider themselves still working for the people. Mohamed Jamjoun has reported many times from Tunisia. He joins me now. Mohamed, we did see tensions within the government for a while now, but no one was expecting this kind of escalation.
You're right. This was a huge escalation, and I've been speaking to contacts in Tunis, and they said that this did come as a surprise, although it was a welcome surprise to many, because there have been repeated protests over the past several months. People in Tunisia have been so fed up with the political stasis in the country, the fact that parliament has not been able to get anything done, especially at a time of crisis like this, when COVID-19 is ravaging the country, when the economy just seems to get worse and worse. Unemployment, especially youth unemployment, is so high. So that's why you had these celebrations that sprang up in parts of Tunis and other parts of the country when the announcement was made that parliament was suspended. The question right now is, are there going to be further demonstrations? Are there going to be demonstrations for what happened and demonstrations against it? Because you had Rachid Ghannouchi, who's the former Speaker of Parliament, parliament, at least in this calculation right now, because he's been fired. And he's called on supporters of Ennahdha, he's the head of that party, to come out and to protest what he calls a coup against the revolution. So if you then have Ennahdha supporters coming out into the streets the next 24 hours, the next few days, and would there potentially be clashes with those who are supporting the president? It's all very murky right now. We just don't know how exactly it's going to play out.
It is very murky, because we can't quite call it a coup.
Right.
But it's not completely constitutionally legal either.
And what makes it trickier, Imran, is the fact that at the moment, the real arbiter of all of this is the president, because there is no constitutional court. The new constitution came into being in 2014. A constitutional court was supposed to have been set up. There's been a lot of disagreement about who would be appointed to that court. And because there is no constitutional court, you have all these questions right now as to the legality of this move by the president. He says he's invoking Article 80 of the Constitution, which allows him to do this. He says he is lifting the immunity of members of parliament, which he is allowed to do. And then he has also indicated that because he's lifted the immunity of members of parliament, that he can then go after them for corruption and for other violations. And so it's going to be very interesting to see if prosecutions happen, if arrests happen, or if this is essentially a lever by which he is going to see who supports him and who he can work with going forward.
Now, in our last hour, we had a guest, a guy called William Morris. Very interesting. What he was saying is that he's looking towards the kingmakers, the so-called kingmakers, the businessmen, the people with influence, the people who own the media, to bring this to a peaceful resolution within the constitution. But a lot of other people are saying, like you just mentioned there, if Ennahdha supporters come out onto the streets, we may well see clashes, and that means the army getting in. So there are two paths here that Tunisia could take, right?
Yeah, and it is very interesting when it comes to the military, because the army in Tunisia does have a lot of popular support. And one of the reasons for that is because when the revolution happened, 2010, 2011, the army was supportive of the people, whereas the police went after protesters. Right. So one of the questions that comes into play in the next few days is, would there potentially be a split amongst the various security forces? We just don't know at this stage. At this point, it looks like the army is remaining neutral, although one thing that was mentioned in that guest segment last hour was the fact that the army did not allow Ghannouchi, who's the head of parliament, to enter parliament. He tried to do that a few hours ago. And so it comes up now. How much is this going to be based on political divisions? Is the army going to play more of a role? Is that going to add fuel to this fire? I will say this, from speaking to the people I've been speaking with in Tunisia, there is a lot of fatigue in that country. They just want to have a functioning government. And it doesn't seem at this moment as though people want to see violent scenes play out. So that might be a saving grace going forward. But again, this is all very much an open question. And because so many people are referring to this as a coup against the revolution, what's the perception of that going to be? Is this going to be seen as a power play, or is this going to be seen as something essentially to save the country?
Great to get your thoughts, Mohammed. He'll be with us for the next few hours.